Let me just start by clarifying a few things before that dislike ratio gets higher than Rotishaw in Ibiza. 1. I did not think the show was that off. 2. I watched JJ for like 5 years before you all call me a hater. 3. Literally 50% of my channel's views are from KSI's music, so I clearly like it before someone tries to claim that I hate his music. Also, by the way, there'll be no footage from the show that wasn't in any of the promotion, cause I don't want to be claimed. What's up guys, it's MGenius here and welcome to a brand new video where today we are going to be reviewing the KSI show. It happened a few hours ago when I'm recording this and it's still clear in my memory. And my general opinion of it is, it's just a bit average, I guess. There were a lot of great moments during the show, like Logan fucking Paul calling JJ a fat neek, the sidemen being old and grey, which coincidentally is also how Josh feels in his daily life. Let's start with the pre-show. Seemed like quite a normal introduction. They mainly just showed footage of JJ seeing the set and how it was made and stuff. Later we saw Simon talk about how he makes JJ do whatever he says. Or, I mean, close enough. Josh looked like he missed the retirement home and straight into the interview. JJ gave his manager a heart attack, Vic waffled for a bit, and throughout the show you can see Harry do his best impression of Madeleine McCann. And then, a whole more Sidemen video later, the show was about to begin. A 90-minute show that had been months in the making was apparently spent $2 million on. That would break the internet, according to Knowledge, Strength and Integrity himself. And, well, it did. For those people whose ticket was apparently in use by others and got this message. After the performance of Down Like That with SX, we get the first skit of the show, which shows KSI with Jonathan Ross as his assistant, wakes up on a couch apparently before the biggest show of his career. Jonathan Ross then asks to bring his girlfriend, who's a horse for some reason. This will somehow be relevant to the show. JJ forbids it, cause, well, it's a horse. He then runs like 4 meters outside the door and gets tired, which, to be fair, is the most realistic part of this skit, to ask Jonathan to get him a water. Then starts another performance, this time of Houdini, with Tina Wayne, which then transitions into Gang Gang from all over the place. After the performance, JJ gets kidnapped and performs Domain in the back of the van with multiple KSI lookalikes, which is also something that recurs throughout the show. Then the next skit begins with Barris voiced by Jack Whitehall. JJ talks about killing Barris, and then Jack reminds him that toy bears aren't alive in the first place. Jack then talks about how JJ has apparently changed since the first time he won Barris. He talks about JJ has become an asshole, and which JJ argues before shouting at Jonathan Ross for not taking any sushi. That was a joke that he hired actual TV show writers for, and that was one of the actually good ones. After that intentional ironic joke comes the funniest unintentional ironic joke, where Dan Bilzerian, by far the most hated guest on the show, plays actual God. A man I didn't even really know about like 4 days ago, to be honest, but now know enough to know exactly why everyone hates him. A trust fund millionaire who pays women to hang out with him, filmed himself asking a cop for a gun during the Las Vegas shooting, and has more lawsuits than I can be bothered naming. Now, I get that he probably insisted on being in the show, cause it's his company that sponsored it, but surely someone on the writing team would see just how ironic it is that the worst person on the show is introduced as our Lord and Savior. Anyways, Dan just calls JJ an asshole and chills out his book. Jack, or Barris, I guess, talks about how JJ will be meeting some kind of ghost from his past, and then JJ walks away in the middle of the conversation. Later, JJ walks through a hallway back into his back room of the show while mocking the idea of ghosts. He then sits in front of a TV, where he sees the ghost of Emmy Leskey, who somehow appears on the same couch as JJ. Heskey talks about showing JJ's videos, which horrifies JJ when he finds out that it's his old videos. Heskey times start playing in the best performance of the hour, before Jump Around makes Heskey's hair look like an overgrown pineapple. Lamborghini is the last song Heskey shows him, while JJ tries to convince him that he's changed. Jonathan Ross then brings his ladies to JJ's room. JJ leaves to perform for the stage, where Randy comes out for a performance of BRS, with multiple backup KSIs return. While J1 comes on stage to perform Swerve, and then JJ performs Madness with more laces than England vs Denmark at the Euros. Uncontrollable is the last performance before the next skit, which takes place in a studio stuck in a kind of dream state. The skit is with Lorraine, where she effectively insults him politely and judges him for doing stuff for money. We then see Jonathan Ross get rejected by an actual horse that jumps over a toy fence. We then just see the trailer for All Over the Place again as a transition into the next segment of Lorraine's skit, where AJ Tracy shows us how to make instant noodles, which is his only contribution to the show, despite actually being in a song with KSI. The next scene of the show takes place in a boxing ring, with a screen at the floor where ladies in the ring talk about Vic stealing their heart and liking bears. There's another appearance by the fake KSIs. The boxing announcers talk about digital farm animals' involvement or lack thereof, and then the performance kicks in. Then there's Really Love with Craig David, which transitions into You from the new album, which morphs into Patience, but they also couldn't get Polo G. Then the stage becomes a hypnosis video while JJ performs the moment with the backups. The next skit's probably the best one of the show. JJ appears in what looks like an old age home. It shows all of the sidemen in the future, except Harry, who was asked to record another Golf It video and fucking died. It looks like they're all in mourning, which JJ assumes might be for him, before a B-Tech Darth Vader appears in front of him, claiming that he's JJ from the future, before revealing that it's Logan Paul, who ended up joining the Sidemen after they kick KSI out for being a brat. Suddenly, Jonathan Ross, who's apparently called Michael, goes up to Logan as his assistant slash friend, reminding him that he has to perform his hit song, KSI is a Fat Nuke. Then there's some shite about how Jade is gonna change and become nice and stuff. The best moment of the show then takes place as we get to see Logan Paul somehow say the words, KSI is a Fat Nuke. JJ then wakes up vibing to Logan's song, and we're back at the start where Jonathan Ross is asking to bring the horse to the show. JJ then shows exactly why people say he acts like a supervillain and monologues about how he'll never change or something like that. After that, we go back into the performance, this time of Lighter with Ella Henderson and Nathan Dorr. Followed by that, we are shown a performance of Sleeping with the Enemy with SX, which changes into Holiday. At this point, an hour had passed, and the show seemed nothing major, but not awful either. And since we'd been promised 90 minutes, we expected that there'd be a lot more to come. I mean, the rematch, or at least pretend rematch, of the fight, which had been used in every single trailer, had not been seen yet. But after the performance of Holiday, it just started showing the bloopers, which seemed weird, but surely the fight'd be after that, as a kind of grand finale, surely. The viewers weren't exactly pleased, to say the least. It just felt kind of incomplete. Then they actually rolled the credits, and everyone in the chat was fuming, before JJ comes on the screen and starts talking about how he hopes everyone enjoyed the show. They did not. Before the scene changes into that shot, the one shot used to promote the show more than anything else. You know the one. Logan and JJ walking side by side into a boxing ring. It looked like it was happening. Finally, we're gonna see what everyone spent like 20 pounds and an hour of their lives waiting for. They step in the ring, chat for a few seconds, waltz to the middle, and then they both throw a punch. And nothing. It just freezes. I thought it was some network issue, because there were a few during the show. But then it zooms in and fades to black, which pissed the fuck out of chat. And to be honest, rightfully so. The main event, it had been clickbait. They might as well have used this fucking clip, and it would have had the same reaction.
Clickbaited!
The show, in terms of music and as a concert, was great. I doubt many people have problems with that. It's the fact that it had been hyped so much as this blockbuster entertainer that KSI spent millions on, that we had to pay for, right? as it was a one-time-only show. It had writers of an actual TV shows, skits, and what was the most hype, not exactly by JJ, but more from every promotion of it, was the fight, the Logan Paul rematch. We would, after like 2 years, finally see JJ in the ring again. And that's why they decided to make it their clickbait. JJ's acting in this was slightly better than Laid in America, but then again, that movie released like 5 years ago. And did anyone pay to watch that? The skits weren't bad, but they wouldn't have looked out of place in a YouTube video, which you wouldn't have had to pay for. If the show was advertised as a concert, it probably would have lived up to expectations, or maybe even exceeded them. But since it was portrayed as a show, the KSI show, nonetheless, it was expected to be a comedic affair with a few musical performances sprinkled in, as his album had just released the day prior. Instead, we got an online concert with a game of guess which celebrity will appear now, in the middle of it. To end this video off, I'd say my thoughts on the show are it was mainly advertised in a misleading way, and that despite a few memorable moments, this could have been a main channel video. Ignite got more appearances in this show than Steven tries in any Sidemen video. The lip syncing was a bit shit, but that does happen at a lot of concerts, so I'll slightly allow it. Also, it was supposed to be a one-time thing, hence why we had to see it live. Overall, it wasn't really as entertaining as an E-Boys video, and that's saying something. That's gonna be it from me. Let me know your opinions in the comments. Do you agree or disagree? Let me know. Like the video, and peace.